Hello, and welcome to Dogs with Torches, Episode 9. If you could live during any historical period, be it ancient, modern, or contemporary, of which would you choose? In this podcast episode, we will be discussing briefly the period of time that preceded medieval Japan, known as the Heian period. We will discuss the breakdown of imperial authority that occurred over time, and we will examine the different political and economic trends during this period, as well as the persistent patterns of familialism that would eventually pave the way for the later Warring States era. Thank you all so much for listening, and enjoy the podcast episode. I'm sorry that it's been so long since the last podcast episode. I had to take a brief hiatus due to all the schoolwork that was happening during the last 4 months, but now that it's summer, we should be up and running with more frequent releases of podcast episodes. Now, the reason why I wanted to discuss the Heian period, the period of time that came before medieval Japan, is because I think it would be beneficial to have a grasp of the political structure and system of governance that came before the Warring States era. As this is a podcast channel mainly used to discuss the medieval era, I will eventually be releasing a podcast episode that focuses exclusively on feudal and medieval Japan. But before we discuss this, it would be good to discuss the period of time that came before the Warring States, and to show how much the failures of imperial rule and ineffectual leadership of the emperors of Japan eventually led to the shift of power into the hands of familial clans, most especially, in this instance, that of the Fujiwara. Now, before we discuss the Heian period, a period roughly dating from the late 8th century to the 11th century, we should also give a brief mention to the period that preceded and shaped it, namely the period known as Nara period. Prior to the socio-political developments of the Heian period, Nara gave rise to the ideal of the state in a strong, centralized monarchy. Japanese society at this time was in a nation-state in comparison to the Chinese, and through adopting the Chinese ideals of the sovereign, the transcendent state, and centralized bureaucratic government, the Japanese molded their governmental structure off of Imperial China so as to create a centralized sovereign and imperial court. Specifically, under the so-called Taika reform, there was a general increase in power of the sovereign, and a system of taxation was put in place during this time. In addition to this, the imperial court consolidated its power by creating an official capital as a center of bureaucracy and economy. This city was called Nara, and it is the city in which the period of history receives its name. So now that we have a brief background into the governmental structure of early Japan, we turn now to the Heian period. What characterizes this period of Japanese history is the initial consolidation and further strengthening of imperial powers in Japan, the eventual rise of power in the house of the Fujiwara clan, its manipulation of ineffectual puppet emperors, and the eventual downfall of the Fujiwara familial clan. What also characterizes this period is the rise in shōen, or hereditary estates, which were exempt from taxation and governmental rule, as well as innovations in literature and religious fervor. In the beginning of the Heian period, Emperor Kamu was made emperor in 781. What is particularly significant with his rule is that he decides to move the capital from Nara to the province known as Kyoto. The reason for this is because the emperor was concerned about the increase of authority many of the Buddhist monks were exerting within the city of Nara. In addition to this, we find in Kamu's leadership an interest in consolidating greater power in his reign, and during this time, the emperor allied the official police strongly with the imperial court and its intentions, so that the ministers of peace were, in many ways, the extended arm of imperial authority in the various provinces of Japan. Several new court titles and positions, such as that of the household treasurer, or the Kurando Dokoro, came to be created at this time. In terms of military strength, the emperor was able to quell a rebellion in northern provinces of Japan and extend his kingdom. Through the efforts of the generals Otomo Otomaru, and Sakanoe Tamuramaro, the imperial borders were stretched to the very tip of the island of Japan. This all shows the strength and centrality of the imperial court during the early Heian period. Unfortunately for the Japanese sovereign, the imperial court exercised considerably less influence in subsequent years due to the influence of the familial house known as the Fujiwara clan. While the imperial court of Japan attempted to follow the system of government exemplified by its Chinese cousins, it would soon undergo severe restrictions in its imperial authority, so that the power of the emperor wielded was merely nominal, with the real power and authority exercised by the House of the Fujiwara as acting regents. In the year 850, the emperor lost much of his power due to extensive marriage arrangements made between the imperial court and the Fujiwara family. This prominent clan was an ancient familial house, with its influence going all the way back to some of the first administrators that would push for the Taika reform during the Nara period. During this time, the imperial family was literally wed to the Fujiwara clan, as it became expected that the emperor and his successors would take for their wives Fujiwara ladies. One particularly prominent Fujiwara was Fujiwara no Yoshifusa. And due to the familial ties made with the imperial court, Yoshifusa eventually took on the title of regent alongside the emperor, and his successors would follow this tradition of attaining regency. Due to these connections in court, the power wielded by the head of the Fujiwara family, the clan dominated the politics of the late Heian period. The Fujiwara were the ones who determined who would be chosen as emperor, because the European laws of primogeniture, which entailed that the eldest son would inherit the throne and inheritance, did not exist for medieval Japan. Because of this, the Fujiwara were able to manipulate the court into choosing the children of Fujiwara ladies as the successors. In addition to consolidating power at court, the Fujiwara would also gain power through uniting large tracts of land known as shōen. We will discuss shōen later on in the podcast, but suffice it to say, these tracts of land were a powerful commodity to possess during this time, and it is through their development that the system of feudalism will eventually be brought about. The Fujiwara would continue to dominate the imperial court during the Heian period, and under Fujiwara no Michinaga, the family was as closely allied to the emperor as ever, with his four daughters all becoming royal consorts, and the fifth daughter becoming the wife of the ruling emperor's son. Michinaga's power had lasted from 996 to 1027, where under his reign as regent, his family clan had acquired wealth, power, prestige, and most especially in the case of the number of shōen acquired during this time. Unfortunately, towards the end of the Heian period, the Fujiwara would lose considerable power and influence in the court. The reign of the Fujiwara came to an end with the reign of Emperor Go Sanjo, whose mother was not a Fujiwara lady. Whereas most of the emperors were more than willing to allow for the Fujiwara to function as regent, Go Sanjo was far more assertive in the beginning of his rule. One of the first displays of authority came when he reformed the system of shōen distribution. The emperor set up an imperial record office and demanded the confiscation of all shōen granted after 1045, after it became apparent of forged legal documents. In addition to this, Go Sanjo reformed the governors put in charge of provinces of Japan. Due to the prior influences of the Fujiwara, the governors were allied closely with the intentions and interests of the Fujiwara family. Wanting to displace Fujiwara influence from the imperial family and government, Go Sanjo made it clear that only the emperor would be appointing the provincial governors henceforth. Now, ultimately, the emperor would still negotiate with the Fujiwara at this time. As they still claimed great authority in the court, the emperor could not simply dismiss them altogether. At the same time, the Fujiwara would never be able to consolidate the same power they wielded with previous emperors, as both Go Sanjo's son and grandson would continue the strong imperial reign long after his death. Go Sanjo would eventually retire in 1072 and join the cloistered life of a Buddhist monk. And while this seems like an obvious setback of power, Go Sanjo would still control and monopolize much of the imperial court without concern for the ceremonial aspects of the position. After his death in 1073, his son, Shirakawa, would succeed him, and after him, his grandson, Toba, would succeed him as well. Now that we've discussed the rise and fall of the political figures at this time, we now turn to the system of tracts of land and manorial estates known as shoen. Originally, shoen were fields of rice given to monasteries as gifts by the monarchy. Later, during the Heian period, the court would pay its courtiers and compensate for their services through shoen. These would eventually accumulate in larger families into sprawling estates that were under the direct control of the familial clan. What made shoen particularly important was that they were typically exempt from imperial control, with some being even free of taxation laws and governmental administration. Now, while much of the land was distributed by imperial authorities, shoen were also in part created by the lower classes. Similar to medieval Europeans giving their money and land to the church so as to hold it in abeyance, much of the peasantry would give their land to the aristocracy for both protection as well as exemption from taxation. In exchange for this, the aristocracy would receive a portion of the harvest cultivated on the land by the peasantry. With these large swaths of land held outside the control and jurisdiction of local governments, we see the trends towards the dissolution of the imperial state and the unified monarchical system, which will eventually culminate in the Warring States era, with different military houses fighting amongst each other for political power and authority. At the same time, the imperial court at this time would not directly lose its power through the system of shoen, as it was still the emperor who would be granting these privileges, and most of the beneficiaries had strong and central ties to the imperial court to begin with. Now that we've discussed the imperial and familial clans and discussed the system of shoen, we will now briefly look at the literary achievements and genre that were made popular during this period of time. The tradition of using Chinese in imperial documents and official pronouncements was still quite prevalent during this period, but after the Nara period, we find that the language of phonetic Japanese is invented and is used as a popular substitute to the complicated signs and symbols of the Chinese language. Poetry as a form of artistic expression was quite prevalent during this period, and what is particularly interesting is, while much of the poetry was used to describe impersonal forces of nature or the transcendent beauty of the natural, much of the poetry was also expressed in very personal terms, showing experiences of love, familial strife, and daily life in the imperial court. One particularly impressive collection of poems published at the time, the Kokinshu, was completed in 905 and amasses a total of 1,111 poems. In addition to poetry, we find in this period a genre of literature of court diaries known as Nikibungaku. Written almost exclusively by female courtiers, Nikibungaku were extensive accounts of life in the imperial court. As with the poetry at this time, the Nikibungaku were particularly personal, showing conflicted states of the mind, intense emotional states, and psychological responses to the lives of husbands and lovers. One of the more famous court diaries is the Kagero Nikki, a diary accounting the life of one of the wives of Fujiwara no Kanei, the father of Michinaga. Referring to herself only as Michitsuna no Hana, the mother of Michitsuna, the author discusses her exasperation and frustration with her husband's activities and lack of interest in taking care of her, and expresses a general unhappiness with the state of her marriage. She writes of her numerous pilgrimages she undertakes to imperial Buddhist shrines so as to console her, and she especially writes of her wish to become a Buddhist nun and take religious vows in order to be exempt from a life at court. Despite her frustrations with her husband's absence and neglect, she writes in the tone of one who is deeply in love with her husband, Kanei. Finally, no discussion of Heian literature would be complete without discussing the two greatest literary achievements made during this period, that being the so-called Pillow Book and The Tale of Genji. The Makura non Soshi, or The Pillow Book, written by court lady Sei Shonagon, is similar in composition to that of a court diary. But rather than being autobiographical, The Pillow Book discusses the mundane day-to-day activities of people in court and gives a simple commentary on the events that the author has witnessed. In addition to this novel development, the author's overall demeanor is noted to be, rather than being that of a timid or shy courtier, is energetic and less congenial than other court diaries. The author has a rather cavalier and even sarcastic attitude towards much of the ceremony and pageantry at court, and some have even suggested that the author exhibits certain proto-feminist sensibilities in the overall tone of the book. Sei Shonagon even exhibits a general understanding of Buddhism, and yet, almost in a sort of Monty Python-esque fashion, tends to disregard it and speak of the religion irreverently.
And St. Attila raised the hand grenade up on high, saying, O Lord, bless this thy hand grenade, that with it thou mayst blow thine enemies to tiny bits.
In one passage, she even comments about how she wished that preachers and monks were more handsome and charming in their demeanor, so as to attract more attention to their sermons. Sei Shonagon writes as follows, A preacher ought to be good-looking, for if we are properly to understand his worthy sentiments, we must keep our eyes on him while he speaks. Shall we look away, we may forget to listen. Accordingly, an ugly preacher may well be the source of sin. Finally, a discussion of Heian literature would not be complete without briefly touching upon The Tale of Genji. Written by the court lady-in-waiting Murasaki Shikibu, The Tale of Genji is particularly of interest due to it being seen by many historians as the first genuine novel. The work is similar to the epic poetry of Homer's Odyssey in that the main character, Hikaru Genji, undergoes many adventures and romantic relationships during the course of his life. It is also similar to the European courtly love literature that was soon to follow, as one of the main themes in the novel is Genji's love life and romantic pursuits in the context of imperial court. The book is an impressive literary achievement for the Heian period, and the author Murasaki Shikibu seems to be self-conscious about her literary prowess and the significance of her work. In it, she writes, But I have a theory of my own about what this art of the novel is, and how it came into being. To begin with, it does not simply consist in the author's telling a story about the adventures of some other person. On the contrary, it happens because the storyteller's own experiences of men and things, whether for good or ill, not only what he has passed through himself, but even events which he has only witnessed or been told of, has moved him to an emotion so passionate that he can no longer keep it shut up in his heart. Again and again, something in his own life or that around him will seem to the writer so important that he cannot bear to let it pass into oblivion. Thank you all so much for listening to this podcast episode of Dogs with Torches. While this was more so an introduction to the period that preceded medieval Japan, hopefully this summer we'll get to medieval Japan itself and discuss the Warring States era. Be sure to like, subscribe, and share with your friends because, as the angelic doctor says, just as it is better to illuminate than merely to shine, so too is it better to pass on what one has contemplated than merely to contemplate. Thank you all so much for listening, and God bless.